In the past, harsh physical and social conditions produced low levels of living and high rates of emigration. The subsistence economy was based on agriculture, with some fishing and domestic industry. But although a strong cultural tradition persists, local society is changing. Since the 1960s, this rural area has seen modernization in farming and in the development of manufacturing industry, as we'll see in the next program. This program focuses mainly on agriculture and shows how characteristics from the past combine with elements of modern society in the reproduction of local uniqueness. To understand the distinctive character of a place as it is now, we need to know about the past, the previous layers with which more recent processes have combined. A cooperative like this one is one response to the problems of this area. But agriculture by itself cannot sustain a viable community any more than it ever could. What happens to those who cannot or don't wish to earn a living from agriculture? What alternatives are there now that widespread economic recession has reduced the opportunities for emigration? Norman, the younger of the Fuller sons, prefers not to farm, but doesn't want to leave either. What was his alternative? Norman works in manufacturing, in a local knitwear cooperative originally set up by Father McDyer in the 60s.
How long does it take you actually to learn to do this?
About 6 weeks.
6 weeks,
yeah.
To learn how to do it. Do you like doing it, or?
Oh yeah, I do. Yeah.
You really do?
Yeah.
What would you do? I mean, what's your alternative?
Not much, really. You know.
Nothing much.
No.
You don't fancy the farming?
No, I do not. No. Oh no. Ah no. Day farming's gone.
That right?
As far as I'm concerned, yeah.
Well, what would you do if you didn't work in here?
That's hard to say. I did do a bit of welding, like might have gone on for that, maybe.
Well, you'd have had to leave here, though,
yeah.
Wouldn't you?
Yeah.
I mean, you wouldn't have got work around here.
No, I wouldn't have, no. Killy Meggs is the nearest you'll get work in that line.
Is that right?
Yeah, of course. But too far to travel.
Well, certainly. But you, so you like working in here?
Yeah, I do, yeah.
Because it keeps you in the area?
Yeah, more or less, yeah. Mm-hmm. More or less, yeah. Mm-hmm. Quite good, too, you know. Nice and close to home. Yeah. And there's no travelling expenses, anything like that, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know everybody you're working with, and you know.
Friendly atmosphere?
Yeah, a very friendly atmosphere, yeah.
The local knitwear cooperative is successful, but it has been very difficult to establish industry in this and other similar areas. Industrial tradition have all combined to make modern industrial development difficult. Father McDyer, who came to the area in the 1950s, was well aware of these problems.
I knew in my heart of hearts that if we opened up the place to industrialization, that we were thereby running the risk of negating the culture in the place. I spent, as I said, 2 years going around the country trying to entice government-sponsored industry and private industry to start up here. And eventually, and I had to write to the head of government to get it done. I got one factory, a government-sponsored industry, hand-weaving factory. But I was so disillusioned with the whole attitude of these people. I couldn't blame the private enterprise for not coming in here because it's an isolated, remote place. And so I came to the conclusion that if we were going to get anywhere, we would have to do it ourselves. And that launched me into the cooperative idea.
But getting the necessary capital proved to be a problem. Father McDyer toured the United States in the early 60s collecting money from Donegal Americans. He formed partnerships with private and state-owned companies to get technical and marketing help. He built on traditional skills and local resources. For example, wool was produced in the region and people were involved in spinning, weaving and knitting to supplement farm incomes. basis of this home working economy, McDyer set up one of the first cooperatives in southwest Donegal.
The sole surviving cooperative at the moment is the knitting cooperative. The others are in being and they're doing well, and I hopefully do very well. I think sufficient has been done to give the people of Glencolum Hill confidence in their future, and B, to maintain the generation at a reasonable level, you know.
Not all Father McDyer's projects were successful. A traditional culture is often resistant to new ideas. There were divisions in the community, allegations that Father McDyer had become overextended and was too domineering.
A sort of an us and them mentality developed, which was quite unfortunate, because in a true cooperative, it's all us, there's no them. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, quite a small group of us were left holding the baby, so to speak. But the cooperative idea, though it didn't maintain, it was responsible for initiating various things that would never have been initiated were not so.
One of these is now a privately owned fish processing plant, but was originally a vegetable canning cooperative. Why did this transformation occur?
Unfortunately, they didn't have enough good land here, and so we had to go elsewhere. And then we were told by an expert that we would have to modernize our machinery, but we couldn't reach to that. Rather than turn the key in the door, then we started a fish processing factory, which is going quite good.
The fish processing company is expanding and has invested over £1 million in new plants like this cold storage shed, over half of the money coming in grants from the state authority, and the EEC. Much of the produce here is destined for the international market. These crabs are going to Europe. Another private company in the area is involved in the fashion industry. Donegal Woolen Products is a spin-off from the knitting group. Started in 1976, selling almost completely to the home market. But since then, it has had to develop new markets in America and Japan, as well as in Europe. Its owner, Jim Dugan, explains why.
The business women is very labour intensive, and the garments are very individual. And we can't compete with large mass producers. So we have to find a customer that would appreciate the quality, and the only place that customer is the upmarket.
With such far-flung markets, the poor communications and remoteness of Donegal are a major problem, as is the local inexperience of factory work.
There's very little industrial history here. All work here has been on a casual basis, fishing and farming. It's very difficult for us to kind of get local people attuned to working 50 weeks a year from 9 to 5, and to appear in every day. But the quality, at the same time, they'll be much more conscientious, more loyalty to the company.
Jim Dugan feels that despite their lack of industrial experience, his workers are solidly behind him. This, combined with high-quality goods for export markets, had brought success to his company. It's now expanding and moving into a large factory left empty by the closure of a government-subsidised multinational company making synthetic carpet yarn. What caused the branch plant of a large multinational to close down in an area where industrial jobs are scarce? Maynooth College Geography Department published a study about the area. One of its authors explains some of the background to the closure of the multinational. Colm Regan.
Well, when we did the study here in 1980, we did our fieldwork here in 1980, we subsequently came back to the area about six or seven times up to 1982, and we interviewed the management before the plant closed down, and they mentioned particular items that seemed to them to cause a problem in terms of investment in this area. Specifically, they mentioned the lack of an industrial consciousness among the workers. Then the manager particularly singled out absenteeism, laziness, and a general unwillingness to fit in with what he described as proper industrial relations. Subsequently, we interviewed the workers, and we got a different story from them. They referred to the domineering attitude of the management. They referred to the fact that the management seemed to be inflexible in that many of the workers were also involved in part-time farming, and that there wasn't any flexibility worked into the plant and relations in the plant to allow them to do part-time farming for harvesting, for taking hay and things like that. They also referred to the fact that the plant itself physically was a problem in that they didn't like the interior with no windows. And many of the workers told us that they were would have much preferred to work down the road in the Udras plant in Kilcar. They felt that the climate in the plant in Kilcar was better, that management appreciated a little bit more closely the problems and the traditions and the culture of the area, and that there was the possibility of introducing flexibility into working relations so that people could do part-time farming and at the same time hold down an industrial job. And also they felt that the management were much more in tune with what was going on locally and had much more appreciation of local culture.
The Kilcar complex is totally owned and managed by Udras na Gaeltachta, the state development authority which promotes industry in Irish-speaking areas. Tom Reddington, manager of the Kilcar weaving factory, explains the local characteristic of combining part-time farming with factory work.
Over the last number of years, with shorter working hours and more holidays, we now have a break at Easter. We have a week at Easter, we have a week at Christmas, and 2-3 weeks in the summer, depending. And we might work some Saturdays to make up these weeks. It's usually something that can be worked out between the supervisor and the worker. If he has, I'm not a farmer, I don't know much about it, but if somebody wants to save their hay or wants to do whatever, they want a day or 2 days off, they can usually agree with the supervisor that they'll work late for so many hours or work Saturday and take a day off.
Originally, Kilcar was a state-owned handloom weaving operation condemned for closure in the 60s. It had been using traditional methods of production, warping the yarn by hand before weaving it on hand looms. Hand weaving is slow and time-consuming. Weavers had worked in this way for generations, but a government-commissioned report claimed that output and productivity were too low to be economically viable. The Kilcar community was up in arms when their livelihood was under threat. The local management and workforce fought to get power looms introduced as the only option to closure. The local community, which was very dependent on the Kilcar plant, fully supported a change to the new methods.
They played a very big part, in fact, because we're trying to forget, we're talking about Atkins was 1969-70, that's now 12 years ago. And for the next 3 or 4 years, it was a coordinated effort, because there's no point, say, my saying something was on or a few other people with me, and we needed the full support of the whole local community, and they were in there pushing all the time. They were chasing from a political angle or from any other angle. In fact, at one stage, it got to the point where it was a big sell to prove to people locally that this was a factory that was out of date, and we were going to have to let a lot of people go. But within 1 or 2 years or 3 years, we could be back to where we were again. If this thing took off, that we could be back on 2 shifts and 3 shifts. Well, it took a lot of convincing to convince unions and the people generally that this wasn't some kind of a dream or something. And they did, they accepted this.
The factory showed that with power looms it could compete in modern international markets. With political pressure from the community, the state authority invested capital in new power looms. A modern spinning factory and dyeing plant were added, and more workers were taken out. The car's economic future seemed more secure. The general problems associated with the world recession were compounded by more local problems.
The main problems are the same as anybody else living in this area. It's the infrastructure, I suppose we call it. It's the phones and the roads and the transport. It's just atrocious. That the phones, you can spend an hour or 2 hours trying to get a call through to Dublin, or if you want to ring somebody in Germany or France, well, you know, you can forget it. So that we do lose business on the phones and the telex and the roads, definitely.
These problems also help explain why the multinational carpet yarn factory closed down.
Well, the closure related to international factors like the recession in the textile industry. It also related to the problems of the area here, problems of poor infrastructure, roads in particular, given that the input had to be brought in and then trucked back out again. Problems of telecommunications. The management here consistently told us that they had problems with using the telephone and telex systems. And then there were problems that were specific to the plant itself, problems involving what we could describe as a clash between the cultures of the management and the cultures of the people who worked in the plant. They were very specific to the plant itself.
This closure had knock-on effects, particularly on the dyeing plant in Kilcar. The raw wool input to the spinning factory is first dyed a variety of shades and colours, then blended together to give the wool its distinctive character. The large-scale investment in the dyeing plant was justified by the fact that it serviced the multinational carpet factory and another factory further north. The closure of both these factories meant that the dyeing plant was reduced to working very inefficiently, at less than 10% of its full capacity. Maintaining positive linkages between small-scale local industries in areas like this is one of the tasks in peripheral development. For example, wool from Kilcar gives firms such as Jim Dugan's or the Knitting Cooperative an easily accessible source of yarns which can be coloured to order. It also enables them to operate without having to hold large stocks of yarn themselves. Despite the problems of peripheral development, there has been considerable local industrialisation, and unemployment in Donegal is low by contemporary standards. Tourism has recently developed as an important aspect of the local economy. Some of the area's characteristics, like its remoteness and its traditional culture, are precisely what makes it attractive to increasing numbers of visitors. This has brought back an interest in local crafts. The hand looms are back in use to produce wall hangings and other craft items. Developments like the Holiday Village in Glencolmkill were boosted by the initiative of Father McDyer. But what effect has increased tourism had on the local culture and language?
Tourism is particularly obnoxious in obliterating local traditional culture because tourists come from afar, whether it's from this country or other countries. And naturally, people in an isolated place like this are inclined to ape the tourists in their way of life and in their value, and particularly in their mode of speech. The Yale is here in charge of a folk museum. If they meet tourists, as they do, they have to converse in English. So very gradually, the Irish spoken residue that we have here is becoming eroded through the development of tourists. Now, of course, it's a catch-22 question. Are you going to leave this into a sort of an Indian reservation and have no development at all, or are you going to risk the language and the culture by having development? I came down heavily on the side of the latter because I claimed that if you didn't have development, you would soon have no people here at all. But I do think having got a certain amount of development going, industrial-wise and tourist-wise, then you've got to work twice as hard then to try to restore the values that have been lost, and especially the language that has been lost.
The Kilcar community is working hard to restore the Irish language and traditions. Michael O'Donnell was shop steward in the Kilcar factory, but he's now leader of the Irish Council. What is it doing about restoring the language?
Well, we attacked that on many fronts. First, we set up a cultural organization in the parish, which had looked after all the aspects on the cultural line. For instance, take the language now. We did see that, of course, the language is the life of Ireland. It is the heart of Ireland, in a way. And for that reason, we had to do something about a language that appeared to be slipping a bit over the last few years.
However much the Irish language might be slipping, the area itself has been revitalised. Emigration has been stemmed, and the local population is increasing for the first time in living memory. A new synthesis of economy and culture is in the making. There are formidable problems on both fronts.